The title of session is Towards Criteria and Indicators for Fire Risk and Control. So we'll have two speakers in this session, and we'll be talking about different aspects or concepts that relates to fire risk for peatlands. How we can map fire, how we can assess the risk, do the fire risk assessment. Those will be covered by two speakers. Our first speaker in this session is Dr. Mo Taufik. He is currently a lecturer at Department of Geophysics and Meteorology at Bogor Agricultural University, IPB, in Bogor, Indonesia. He finished his PhD from Wageningen University in Netherlands, and his research focuses on hydrological aspects of peatlands. His talk title today is Peatland Hydrological Drought and Fire Risk Assessment in Changing Climate. So very interesting, very topical, I would say. So Mo Taufik, if you're ready, over to you.
Okay, Rupesh, thank you very much for the time. Do you see my presentation?
Yes. Can you make it a slideshow more?
Yeah. Do we still have a time for this webinar? Because it's only past 3:30, right?
Yeah, we are moving along, I think. We are 10 minutes behind, thanks. But yeah.
Okay, everyone, good day. I'm happy to be here in the webinar. I will present my work in the past 5 years. It's about hydrological drought and associated peatland fires in tropical Indonesia, actually. So for the to begin with, I will introduce what we already have now about the degraded peatland and contribution to GHG emission in Indonesia. It's very huge carbon emission every year. And also we have a problem with biodiversity decline due to degraded peatland in Indonesia. And most of degraded peatland in Indonesia is associated with forest fire or land and forest fire, land and forest fires. What happened if we already have what in the right picture? It's about BRG doing peatland restoration through canal blocking. Do we will have a different behavior of hydrological drought or forest fire in this kind of ecosystem? Therefore, we like to explore the effect of this contrasting management, either degraded peatland and derivating peatland related to fire hazard in Indonesia. My approach is we use hydrological modeling in Indonesia. It based on our last paper published in ERL. It's about hydrological drought in Indonesia. Most of water in peatland lost due to drainage. So therefore, canal water level is very important aspect of canal water level is very important aspect of hydrology in the peatland. It's controlled groundwater level in the land. Our approach is we simulate groundwater level in the land due to the changing of water level in the canal. So we compare to degraded peatland and also the derivating peatland. I try to simulate the groundwater level and forest fire for 1980 until 2015. It's around 36 years, climate years. So I hope it also can see the climate pattern for the region. Then we focus on Central Kalimantan around in Sebango to do this simulation. For fire drought index, we use a common drought index called Kichpirem drought index. Here we call as KBDI. KBDI is just soil water depletion in peatland. It's depend on DQ. DQ is a drought factor, depend on the evapotranspiration and also depend on rainfall. In my approach, because groundwater table is close to the surface, we propose to have a groundwater table as a proxy, as a factor to reduce drought every day. Here's is the formula for this approach. Then the result of my research, first we synthesis that groundwater table in degraded peatland and in rewetting peatland is quite different. You can see here in the orange, in red color is the degraded peatland, and in the blue color is the restored peatland. This is the box plot for 1980 until 2015 period. So we make a summary of this water table. The frequency of daily groundwater table for the restored peatland is quite high. It's less than 40 centimeter for all of the time, but it's different with the degraded peatland. For the degraded peatland, most of the time, more than 60% is below the critical threshold of 40 centimeters. What happened next with the fire hazard? Based on this groundwater table, then we simulate the fire hazard and compare between degraded and restored one. For the degraded peatland, the fire hazard that on the high criteria mean it's a high fire hazard, is more than 10%, whereas for restore one is less than 80%. It's a big difference between of two. If we look at in the low hazard, for the graded one is around 91, but for the restore one is 97. So there are 7% difference between degraded and restore. So we can use this the low hazard or the hazard class to be one of the criteria to assess the biophysical attribute and peatland fire of restore peatland. From this simulation, we can see that rewetting peatland can reduce the fire risk by 30% if we compare the high hazard with the low hazard. A hazard in restored peatland compared to degraded peatland. Then we move to my other study. It's about critical groundwater table for peat fire. We analyze around 160 stations from BRG station, but it's only for 2 years, 2018 and 2019. Baru mean the new station built by BRG, and the Sesame is from Japanese government. If we use both station, Baru and Sesame, we can conclude that most of the time, high and extreme criteria for fire hazard occur when the water table is less than 40 centimeter. So if the water table is deeper than 40 centimeter, the probability of forest fire hazard is being high class or extreme class. So therefore, 40 centimeters maybe is a good one indicator as attribute for end peatland fires in the tropical peatland. So for the conclusion of our presentation, monitoring ground level is crucial and technology feasible. As a part of management tool, such scheme may be used as a rebel and fair compliance mechanism, and rewetting peatland improve the ecosystem by minimizing fire hazards. So that's all my presentation. Thanks for the time.
Thank you, Mutafik. You also finished within your 10 minutes, so that's very good. So let's stay on time, and I'll invite our next speaker, Dr. Solahin Manuri, for his talk. And then, since both are focused on same topics, we can have a combined discussion. And in the meantime, if there are any questions, we can address them. Dr. Manuri is a senior advisor at Diameter Consulting, based in Bogor. He has more than 15 years of experience in forestry sector, including sustainable forest management, forest fire management, land use planning, and forest biomass assessment, specifically focusing on peatland mapping using LIDAR and greenhouse gas emission accounting. Solehin completed his PhD from Fenner School of Environment and Society at the Australian National University. And today he will be talking about mapping fire. Can spatially explicit criterion indicator be developed in this context? So over to you, Solehin.
Thank you, Rupesh. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everyone. Thanks for the introduction, Rupesh. So today I'm gonna talk about the fire mapping, and thanks for the invitation. So my title is given by organizer, so I will try to follow the expectations. So I hope it's can meet your expectations. So let me share my screen. Can you see it now?
Yes. You put it on screen show mode. Yes, it's working. Great.
Okay. Yeah, so this is the title that the organizer asked me to contribute. So I'll try to do my best to meet this topic. And yeah, you know that in the past four decades, wildfires have become a common event and repetitive in tropical ecosystem of Indonesia. And this is due to because of this prolonged dry seasons in Indonesia, normally caused by the El Nino Southern Oscillation or ENSO, and also the Indian Ocean Dipole Mode. A result of the unsustainable practice of forest and land management, as previous presenters mentioned earlier. And drained peatland during the dry season become more susceptible to fires, and normally it contributes huge amount of greenhouse gas emissions. And the impact of peat fires in Indonesia is unfortunately quite limitedly explored, or with relatively high uncertainty, in particular regarding the size of the burn areas. So in this presentations, I would like to present some initiatives related with the fire mapping in Indonesia and also in the tropics. As you know that the biggest challenges in mapping fires in Indonesia or in tropical region is because of cloud persistence, which is common in the tropical region, and also due to smoke and haze occurrence during the fires, and also the short windows of opportunity after the fire season ends, which is started during the rainy season. But normally during the rainy season is also cloudy, and once we have a clear sky, the vegetation is already growing. So this is what I mean about sort of windows of opportunity. So it is really important to have really reliable remote sensing data. So as you can see in this, this is from MODIS satellite in over central Kalimantan during 2015 fires, and you can see most are the wind coming from the southeast directions, and you can see that most of the fires are covered by smoke and haze. So this is the challenges, biggest challenges we have so far. And here is the chart about the existing initiatives on fire mapping in Indonesia and also in global tropical, pan-tropical. started in 1992, 1993 fires, Lennox and Panzer did some quite huge studies on fires extensions or fire mapping in East Kalimantan, using Landsat imageries. And then in 1997, again, big fires, bigger than the fires in 1982, 1983. Sigurd and Hoffman also doing the fire mapping using a radar, which is you know, the passive sensor that can penetrate clouds. And in the meantime, the there is also another database on burn area provided by GFED. Now is version 4.0. They already start the mapping since 1995 actually, but they already include the most recent MODIS burn scar area until recently. And then in 2000s, the MODIS burn scar are already so the MODIS satellite is already operational, and there are two types of burn area data sets that are provided by MODIS NASA. They call it MCD-45 and MCD-64. So MCD-64 is the latest version, so it is commonly used by any studies and global and also at national level. So this GFED 4.0 also incorporated the burn area MCD-64A1. And then in 2006, the Ministry of Environment actually Ministry of Environment started the mapping in 2016 to map the fires even in 2015, so where the huge El Nino was occurring. And now they are planning to extend the period until 2006. In order to estimate the emission from pit fires for developing the reference level for red plus activities. So they are doing, it's not published yet, but the one that published is in 2016 or fire in 2015. And at the same time, there is another studies on in Indonesia about the fire mapping using a radar satellite. So this is a Sentinel-1. So this is a passive active sensor. And also Lapan do the three in the years in 2015, 2016, and another one in 2019 also doing the mapping using combinations of Landsat and also Sentinel-1, so the hybrid between optical and active satellite. And yeah, also Copernicus started in 2014 until recently. So yeah, you can see there are four that is continuous initiative in fire mapping in Indonesia. So this is the detail of the methods that the summary of the methods they use. So mostly using Landsat imageries and also radar satellite, and also MODIS. They have a lot of for global scope, for global coverage. They mostly using MODIS satellite, the most recent one is Sentinel-1. So they already using Sentinel, which has two different sensors, optical and also active sensors, with quite you know, often repetition. So from about 5 to 12 days of repetition. So this is quite promising, and most of them are using either object-based image analysis or pixel-based classifications and also visual classifications. So you can see the Ministry of Environment and Forestry, they are using the visual classifications of Landsat imageries with the aid of other auxiliary data like hotspots and also verified by ground data and high resolution imagery. And this is the one that data that we can compare in fires in 2015. So you can see from GFED, Modis, Bernskar, and also studies from Lauberger in 2017, Minister of Environment, Forestry, and also LAPAN. So LAPAN is a space agency in Indonesia. And yeah, the GFED, Modis, and yeah, most of them has data on peatland fires.
So Solihin, you have to wrap up really quickly. Your time is almost
Yeah. So this is basically the comparisons of the and yeah, this one is the summary. Maybe I can skip that. And also we have a pro and cons on the sensor type resolution, also classifications. As you can see in the previous slide, that both sensor are used either passive or active, and LAPAN even using the hybrid using both sensors. And for resolution, most of the national coverage, they use medium, at least medium resolution, from 10 meters to 30 meters. So I think that is better than the low resolutions. And for classifications, yeah, they use manual and also automatic classifications. Yeah, this is the type of satellites we can use, and this is also the lifespan. This is very important when we select the satellite imagery we want to use. So not only because of free, but also the lifespan. So some of them already not operating, so we cannot have the historical or future data for fire mapping. So this is very important to have better knowledge about the lifespan of the satellite. And one more important thing is the accuracy assessment. So this is very important to do. Some are using like high resolution imageries, like the MODIS, the 500 meter resolution MODIS, using 30 meter Landsat for validations, or 25 meter maps validated using the ground measurement and or aerial survey. So this is something that the mapping should be part of the mapping initiatives. And apart from that, also burn pit depth mapping is also one thing that very important, especially when we want to estimate the emissions from pit fires. So accurate informations is really important.
Olehin, you have to wrap up in 30 seconds at the most, otherwise right. We won't have time for the rest of the...
Yeah, this is the last slide. So main message is basically we have already initiatives on fire mapping, and spatially explicit criteria is should be developed depending on the methods and data they use, combined with knowledge from a ground and aerial survey. So I think this is one thing that really important validations. And also selections of methods should be depending on the mapping coverage, reporting interval, and technical capacity. So a lot of variations can be used depending on the needs. Yeah, I think that's all my presentation. Sorry for taking a longer time. Thank you, Rupesh.
Thank you, Solihin. Thank you for sharing. Your presentation was quite informative with a lot of very, very interesting and useful information. I'm sorry we have only limited time, but you did provide a good flavor of where this mapping fire science stands. So just very quickly wrap up, this session on fire was very useful in the sense that we kind of get the two extremes. When first speaker Muthofik talked about this monitoring of groundwater table, and then you know, like right at the level of location, like you know, in the physical, in the field setting, what is happening where, getting the information from that level. While Solihin talked about more from a very kind of a top down, if I can use the term, with the radar and those kind of technology, how you can do the large scale regional mapping. And both of these are quite important. Like in terms of validating the data which is collected at a very broad scale. It becomes very important, like having boots on the ground, someone measuring, someone collecting the data in the field. And I think that the interesting and important aspect is how do you sort of stitch them together into useful, relevant criteria and indicators. So they are useful for people who are practitioners who are has the responsibility of making some decision based on that. So this ties together very nicely with the previous two sessions where it has to be thought up from what are your principles and then criteria and indicators. And all speakers have presented very detailed approaches when it comes to biophysical aspects. There are so many nuances that we need to know. There are scientific approaches, there are technology, there are advancement, but then it becomes a what is cost effective, what is what is good enough. So I haven't seen any specific question coming for this session. There yes. was one in Bahasa Indonesia, which I will request Daniel to translate. And well, that was for Taufik.
That's right. This is for Taufik. Taufik, the question is about groundwater level you presented. How can you use that information to estimate greenhouse gas fluxes? Second question is still related to your categories of peatland. This is from Pablo Martin. How do you categorize peatland is restored and how is it degraded? What kind of criteria you use?
Okay, thanks, Daniel. For the first question, we can use groundwater table as a proxy for greenhouse gas emission, as already mentioned Professor Margaret, I think, from Newcastle. We can use a groundwater table as a proxy, for instance, through Hoyo approach, for instance, to estimate greenhouse gases. For the second question from Pablo, thanks. How to make a classification of degraded and restore. Our approach is just simply, if we have a canal brooking or just a restoration project on there, we will simply, it is a riveting project, so it's riveting peatland. Otherwise, if it is a degraded, that's simplification. Thanks, Pablo.
Thank you, Taufik. Are there any other question? Daniel, did you notice something else that we need yes. to address?
It's very general questions. Maybe anybody can answer that, even from the previous session. It's about the term used as sponge cities. Is it something to do with peatland, or is there any merits about categorizing city as sponge city?
Yeah, if you want to respond, just unmute yourself and you can respond.
While the speakers are thinking, as another one I picked about the canal blocking. I think any of those who speak about canal blocking can respond to that. There is a negative impact also on blocking the canal because it will lower the pH to some extent. Any comment on that?
Yeah, this relates to, I think, the biogeochemistry of soils, how the redox changes and what impacts it has. So any panelists want to take this?
Ruby Kristel.
Sorry, I haven't been working in that area. I don't see really how immediately canal blocking can have an effect on the pH. Maybe this takes some several years. So it's a bit of a tricky question, I would say.
Yeah, and it could also be that there would be some pockets where you could have this effect, and then there would be, at a landscape level, there would be some areas which are not that affected. There was one more, I think, question or comment about the behavior change in terms of fire, because sometimes the soil is dry and it is very vulnerable, but sometimes it's a human action that caused the to ignite. So that is a point very well taken, but there are also natural fires with lightning and all that. So it is has to be taken into account that if peatland is vulnerable because of less water, then it's not only always just human action that the risks are there, of course. So, okay, so I think there is no comment about spawn cities, unless you want to say anything, Parthenial. Otherwise, I think we, in interest of time, I know you have to wrap up and we have to have closing remarks from you. So I will yield the time to you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Rupesh, for sharing very interesting and lively session. We have 172 people in the room, virtual room, and they are very active and watching us. Suddenly, the five speakers have been bringing us an incredible travel right from the sky in the outer space, from the satellite down to Earth, not only on the ground, but also going down below the ground to look at groundwater table, biochemistry, etc. So it's been very rich conversation we have, and this challenged us to really think about, you know, how to use this kind of information, which we call technology. Ravi characterized it as criteria, into the people we are working for. And he's been very clear about that, how to make this people-centered. So this information can be gathered, getting more and more easily today, and how to bring that, to communicate that with people in the context of peat restoration. So the way I see it is really challenging to look at how information that we can generate very quickly and perhaps more and more accurately means something for people. So bringing this into people, you know, conversation, day-to-day conversation is not easy. This is going to be a challenge. How, when we are going to talk with them and verify this kind of thing, and what does it really mean for them? So today we learned a lot from this conversation about those criteria that's been described from the hydrology, from the emission of greenhouse gases, fire, hazard, and risk. So again, what do they really mean for people? So we have a big challenge in front of us, and certainly this will be a very useful way of guiding us towards, you know, verifying these numbers and criteria that is generated. So the indicators that Ravi underlined as information will be based on data. So data is very useful. It can be easily generated now, even if you do it through a virtual way by synthesizing or assessing, reviewing papers that can be generated. But again, what does it mean for people? So with that, I guess we have a lot of challenge in front of us to do. And at the same time, was also challenged by Haris about people around us, about their agenda. So that might be our next round of webinar or discussion to have. So thank you very much again for those who've been very patient and sincere and also patient to follow this conversation and also contribute in question and chat. Thank you for your kind contribution. So with that, I would like to close this webinar of today. And again, for the speakers, we will be having our debriefing session in another room. Thank you.
Thank you.